Hi, everyone. A very good morning, afternoon, or evening to all of you, no matter where you're present in the world. Thank you so much for joining my session today. Really excited to be with you all and tell you about AuroQA. So, just before I get started, I'm Abha. I work as a senior customer success engineer here at Sama and lead the customer success engineering team. And so we partner closely, you know, with our customers, clients, right, to make their machine learning data needs come to life and make sure they get the highest quality in the most efficient way as possible. Today, we're going to talk about supercharging your training data quality using AuroQA. So just at the start, you know, what are we really going to be covering? So we'll talk about a typical quality process, right? What it looks like. We'll talk about AuroQA and what it is. We'll definitely talk about why should you care, right? Why should you spend the next 15 minutes with me? How do we use it here at Sama? I'll share a few examples with you from automotive and high tech. And last but not the least, right, we'll talk about AuroQA in numbers. So with that, let's jump into it. At a high level, what a typical quality process looks like is this, right? You as a client create tasks over API, or, you know, in some cases you might be sending it over manually. Your data trainers annotate the task, right? So this is the actual annotation taking place. And then your task makes it to QA, right? Therein, there's a queue that's building up, your manual QA comes in, they're sampling, say, anywhere between 5, 10, 50% of your tasks. You know, if they approve it, right, the task is delivered to you over API. If they don't approve it, say reject it, the task goes back to the data trainer for feedback or with feedback to improve the task. So really, right, what does a manual QA checklist look like? They're looking at, you know, how are the shapes tight enough, right? Is there clipping? Is there looseness? Have the attributes been selected correctly, right? So, you know, is the car actually red, right? Or is it actually blue? Is it a SUV or is it a, you know, regular four-person car, etc.? Did the person actually miss any objects, right? Which we as know can be very tricky when you're training a training data model. And are there on the opposite end, right, any false positives? So these are really the kind of things, right, you want a manual quality analyst to focus on to make sure that none of these types of errors are making it through to your algorithm or your model that you're training. But then you have AuroQA, and how does that change this quality process? So what is AuroQA? AuroQA are quality checks that assess tasks using a fixed set of rules that are configured to check for invalid combinations of labels. Now, this can be done within a shape, across all shapes, or even across dependencies in the metadata. These rules are flexible and customized to each workflow. So, you know, whether you're training a key points workflow, right, or an object detection or a semantic segmentation, right, anything that might be, right, these rules are customized to exactly what you're focused on and what your end goal is. So with that, how does it change our typical quality workflow? So, you know, you as a client are still creating tasks over API, right? Data trainers annotate these tasks as they pick them up and are self-assigned. Now, the change happens here. Before the task is actually submitted or passed on to manual QA, AuroQA kicks in and actually validates the task against the rules that have been set up. So what this does is it actually omits a certain percentage of errors, right? That you may have a manual QA checking. So once an AuroQA checks these, right, they basically prevent submission. And when they prevent submission, right, the data trainer gets shape-specific feedback that they receive, and then they improve the task on, right, continuing to try to submit till they get it right. And then once finally submittable, this task then passes to the manual QA, right? So again, your manual QA will be checking against their checklist, right, and against the quality rubric that's been set up for them. But some of these checks have already been taken care of. So even before we go into what kind of checks are we talking about, let's talk about why should you care. The most fundamental reason, right, is it allows you to focus your manual quality analyst resources time towards the most critical areas. You know, you as a client are often sampling these tasks, right? So if we could guarantee that a certain type of error would never come across, right, we're saving you time and saving you energy while not at all compromising on the quality of your training data set. And so every task that goes through automated QA, right, has a guarantee that there are no logical errors that are being delivered to you. It also creates an instant feedback loop to prevent logical fallacies, right? Encouraging and helping our agents get it right the first time. So, you know, they see this error message, right? And they learn and they fix it before they move on to the next task. So really the idea is, right, that as you go along, you reduce the kind of errors you're making and focus on getting things the right time. Getting things right the first time. And then it also helps data trainers to adapt quickly to changing project instructions. So, you know, no matter how much we try, right, very often new instructions are added to your workflow. So imagine, right, that I'm looking at this image and I'm like, do I want these cars to be annotated, right? And my new rule is omit any cars that are less than 20 by 20 pixels. Now you can imagine, right, that if I'm introducing this midway, it can be a challenge for an annotator to follow. Herein, an automated QA can kick in, right? And if they do ever annotate objects that are less than 20 by 20, give them an error saying, hey, don't annotate this, right? Don't focus on this. Helping them actually adapt to that new instruction. The same way, right, it actually is preventing errors that are sometimes impossible for a manual quality process to detect. So again, taking the same example, imagine if you or a manual quality analyst, right, had to go ahead and measure each of these cars individually to check if or not they were bigger than 20 by 20, right? It would be time consuming, it would be frustrating. And so what we do there is we make sure, right, that this is handled in an automated way so you can focus your energies where it is most required. Last but not the least, right, it is reducing the time that is spent by manual QA on a typical task and allowing them to focus that time on the more qualitative errors, right, clipping, false positives, missed objects, sample more tasks, right, it'll give you a more confidence in the data set that you're getting back from us, or even, you know, using that time to provide additional feedback and coaching to the, you know, individual team. So, you know, am I looking at a pedestrian or a jaywalker, right? Let's talk about it, kind of a situation. So in altogether, if I had to wrap this up, right, the real goal of auto QA is to improve overall time per task and quality, right? The goal is to reduce time from when the task was created by you to when you receive it back from us. And if that's not convincing for you to listen on, I don't know what is. So what exactly can auto QA do, right? How do we use it at Sama? So what we do with AutoQA is we look at logical checks, right, that have no ambiguity and don't need any human judgment. These errors can include everything from invalid answer combinations, so things that your ontology prevents, uniqueness or preventing repetitions, right? So more than one object being assigned the same unique identifier label when the ontology prevents it. So basically, you know, I know there is only one person in this image, they better just have one nose, right? Or two eyes, but one right, one left, etc., right? We can enforce it, we can look at it. We can enforce size, right? Or prevent a minimum, maximum, or a constant size enforcement. And this is just like the example I was just giving you, right? That is easy to do. And last but not the least, we can do relational checks. And what that means is, right, we give in attributes, right? Does this sub-attribute actually add up? So sure, this is a car, right? Is this an SUV? And if so, right, XYZ. If this is actually not a car, right, this is what it means, so on and so forth. So let's take a look at this simple example. I'm looking at a typical automotive use case in the Mario Kart world. I hope you enjoy that, where my requirement is pretty straightforward. For each vehicle, I want to identify and draw a cuboid, right? So this is a 2D cuboid that you're looking at. We want to draw a bounding box around the driver. We want to identify the driver. Hope you all know your character as well. And then last but not the least, I want polygons around the wheels, right? So remember that as we look at the next few slides. So with that, right, you see immediately that there are a few errors that have been made. First and foremost, right, my minimum pixel rule has been violated. I'm looking for at least 20 by 20 vehicles, right? And so this particular object or car or driver and ATV, right, doesn't qualify. So that rule has been violated. The annotator will then go ahead and delete it, right? You can also see that because each vehicle should be a package deal, right? Your wheels have not been grouped. So, you know, somewhere, right, and a vehicle is lacking wheels. And last but not the least, this driver, right, in vehicle number 3 has not been identified correctly. There are a few more errors. I'm sure some of you have spotted them. So let's take a look, right? In this case, right, you're also saying that not only are these wheels not being grouped, right, you're also missing wheels in this group. So you know, right, that where you need to map those together. So with that, right, you see how automated QA can step in, help you get your annotations right, even before a human picks it up. Let's look at a semantic segmentation use case. So, you know, we're looking at cityscapes data set. I'm sure all of you here are familiar with it. And there are simple tricks that here too, right, we can keep. So for example, has my full scene been segmented? AKA, are there any unannotated pixels? Are there any, you know, has every pixel really been assigned a class, right? When I'm looking at a car, right, is the car on top or of the road or behind it, right? Looking at relative layering and positioning, making sure again that, you know, whatever has been annotated, right, logically and in real world situations makes sense and is acceptable to you from a data modeling perspective and based on what your machine learning model needs. So with that, let's give you some numbers, right? What has AutoQA helped us achieve and how does it help? So for a very complex automated use case, Sama delivered 1 million tasks per month with a 96% tasks without any critical errors. All of those tasks were going through AutoQA and were highly, highly appreciated by our client. In a different situation, we actually met a 99.5% SLA where, you know, we were detecting and tracking vehicles, pedestrians, lanes, road signs, right? You can clearly see the benefits in the automotive use cases. In a high-tech use case where we were comparing two images given well-defined criteria, we saw that once AutoQA was implemented, we saw a huge jump in our annotator scores, right? From roughly an 80% average during training to almost 99%, preventing them from making any logical fallacies. And lastly, but not the least, right, it has saved us on average 1 to 3 manual QA hours, right, per quality analyst per day. And this time has instead been used to focus on one-on-one feedback sessions, sampling more tasks, etc. And so we hope, right, that you as a client can also save these hours on your end. With that, thank you for hearing me out and being a wonderful audience. And I look forward to answering your questions. Thanks so much.